Hello, my name is Stéphane Farou. I am a French database consultant, and I want to show you, on a simple example, how to interface a language such as PHP with SQL. When you connect from your computer to a server on the web, this server returns HTML code, images, multimedia files, and bits of code such as JavaScript or style sheets to tell your browser how to precisely display the HTML page. But what matters is the HTML page. Some pages can be static, and the server can send the file as it is stored. But most often, the page is either built on the fly or retrieved from a cache where dynamically built pages are periodically refreshed. PHP is one of the most popular languages to build pages on the fly. What happens is that you ask the server to return to you, say, page.php. The file, as stored on the server, contains regular HTML tags and bits of PHP code between special tags. But the server usually includes a PHP module that takes the original file, leaves the regular HTML untouched, and uses the PHP code to do many things, including database accesses, and generates additional HTML stuff that takes the place of the original PHP code. What you get in the end is a pure HTML page, but a page made to order. If a database is involved, every independent PHP page must connect explicitly to a database because it's an independent program. However, as it connects through the PHP engine that often runs in the HTTP server, it's usually possible to have the PHP engine maintain permanent connections that save significant overhead. There are several sets of functions to connect to a database. Some of them are generic, abstract layers. Most are specific to a database. I shall be using the generic PDO interface. There are several good reasons for using PDO, which is a clean, object-oriented interface. There is also a very bad one, which is saying that it will make the code portable between databases. The PHP code will be portable, but unless your database accesses are very simple or very poorly designed, it is highly likely that the SQL statements will have to be modified anyway. Whichever the library that you are using, connecting to the database will provide you with a database object or a handler. To execute a query, you will call a method of this object, or pass the handler as a function argument, and you will pass to this method or function a character string that contains an SQL statement. Two possible outcomes. Success or failure. If it fails, there is always an additional method or function that returns the last encountered error. But success may be complicated. If you have run a create, drop, or alter statement, fine. But you don't run these statements in regular programs, just in setup or upgrade programs. If your statement was an insert, update, or delete statement, then you may want to know how many rows were affected by the statement, because a statement that changes no rows is for the DBMS a successful statement. Perhaps not for you. You find in database interfaces a method or function that gives you this information. And of course, the most complicated case is a select statement, because after it has successfully executed, you must fetch into your program the dataset of 0, 1, or several rows that was retrieved by this statement. Before using PDO, you must check which databases can be accessed with your version of PHP. You should write this very small PHP script, save it as info.php, and call it in your browser to see what is available. Scroll down a lot, and you will see the names of the PDO drivers. Here, I have drivers for MySQL, Oracle, the PCI drivers, and SQLite versions 2 and 3. If you need a missing driver, then you must configure PHP with additional libraries and rebuild it. I'm going to show you a very simple blog application. Let's start by creating an HTML page. I'm going to give it the title Sir John's Blog. I include a style sheet to make it look good, a few div tags for styling, an image to be used as banner, and then a title. Let's say that on this blog we want to only display the entries for the current month. I want to display the month name in the title, and this is dynamic information that I want to be automatically updated. Therefore, I include some PHP code. I have to say which is my time zone, not very critical for the month name, but let's say UTC, the Greenwich Mean Time. And I'm going to use the function that formats the current time with a code that corresponds to the name of the month and nothing else. I end my PHP snippet. And even if my HTML page isn't complete, I save it as blog.php. To test what it gives, I'm going to run it through PHP used in command line mode. It echoes the HTML bits, and since we are in October, it correctly echoes October, where the PHP code used to be. This is what will be sent back across the web, pure HTML. Now, I'm going to add more PHP to blog.php to access the database where the blog entries are stored. To connect to the database, I need to provide some information. The driver, which says what type of DBMS I am accessing, and also the name of the machine where the database server resides, as well as the name of the database. In this case, the HTTP server and the DBMS are on the same host, therefore, for the HTTP server that will process the PHP code, the database server is localhost. But we could as well access another machine, which could run any DBMS under any operating system, as long as PHP is built with the right client libraries. The syntax depends on the DBMS. To access Oracle, for instance, I would have said OCI and specified the database server as the host name followed by the service name. Let's return to MySQL. I need to provide a username, say Falstaff, and a password, say Old and Merry. Finally, I'm going to provide attributes to set some specific behavior. I'm going to say that I want a persistent connection, which is basically that when my PHP page connects, it will reuse an existing connection if one is available, otherwise it will create it. The second attribute specifies how errors will be handled. I ask the database client to raise exceptions whenever a database error occurs. By default, if a function fails, it will return null or -1 or something that will mean an error condition, and I'll have to check afterwards for the message. Letting the functions raise exceptions will simplify my code. If I expect exceptions, I'm going to append a try block, and I create a database handler object by instantiating the PDO class. If an exception is raised, I catch it and display the message. I have told you that each and every PHP page needs to connect. If you hardcode the connection information in every page, it will make a password change nightmarish. Therefore, I'm going to insulate the connection information, save it to a file named, for instance, dbconf.php, and then include this file in all the PHP pages that access the database by saying it is required once. I can even save it to a directory that is outside what is exposed on the web and make it readable to nobody but the HTTP server for additional security. On the topic of security, displaying the error message at this stage is probably not the best thing to do. Suppose that for security reasons, you regularly change the password and forget once to change dbconf.php. This is what a visitor to the blog would see. Perhaps you don't want to expose that your site is powered by MySQL, nor that the database sits on the same machine as the HTTP server, nor the username. Some folks might want to take advantage of this. A better way would be to display some neutral error message and email the actual error to someone who can fix the issue. The blog entries are stored in this table that basically contains a date, automatically set, the name of the author, and simply a title and the text of the entry. My query will return the date, suitably formatted to only display the name of the day and its ordinal number in the month. Remember that the name of the month comes in the title, the author name, the title and the text, with a condition that says that the date must be greater than or equal to the first of the current month, and I'm going to display in reverse order of entry. You can see here a typical example of unportable SQL. Data arithmetic and data conversion is very specific. For instance, the condition for Oracle would have used the trunk function to get the date of the first day in the month. Time to append the try block, and I'm going to call the prepare method, to which I pass the SQL statement. If I have a syntax error in my statement, this method will raise an exception. The method returns a statement object that I will use in all subsequent calls. Then I call the execute method of the statement object, which actually identifies the result set and sorts it as required. At that point, all I have to do is to call in a loop the fetch method that returns each row as an array. I just have to echo the information retrieved with the suitable HTML tags. I can use the column names as indices in the array. Note that if you are accessing a Oracle, the name used as an index must be given in uppercase, even if it's in lowercase in the statement. When I'm done, I delete the statement object to make life easier for the garbage collector. Then I catch any exception. Displaying messages here is less critical than during connection. End of the PHP code. I close all of the remaining HTML tags and I'm done. Let's call the page, and here is what I get. My dynamically generated HTML page. What about inserting data then? As user login could take me rather far if I want to do it well, I suppose that the user has already been successfully identified and that the username has been stored into a session variable. I need a page to enter my blog post, which will be a plain HTML page. All of the wrapping will be the same as before. I'm just going to change the title and add a form with three input widgets, one for the title, one for the blog post proper, and finally a button to validate. What is important, though, is that when the form is validated, the data is posted to a PHP script. Let's write this PHP script. First, I initialize session management so as to be able to retrieve the user's name. I get what was posted. And as I'm going to interact with the database, I need to create a PD object, that is a database handler. If something goes wrong, I build up a message that contains the description of the error and send it to the right person, while I display some soothing message on the screen. Let's now deal with insertion of data. I write an insert statement which inserts null, where I want a system-generated number, the current date, and placeholders for the values, the equivalent of arguments for a function. They are identified by a name that starts with a colon. I will then prepare the statement as before, but before executing it, I'm going to specify what are the parameters to my statement. I'm using the bindParam method that says which is the name I gave in my statement, which PHP variable contains the actual value, and what type of data we have. Here, in all cases, it's a character string. Then, I can execute the statement, and I abort if it fails. If it works, then I call the blog page so as to display the new entry. I must indicate here the server address as seen from the internet, not localhost. Let's run it. So, I'm identified as full staff. I create a new entry. I submit it. This calls newpost.php. The values I've entered are retrieved. The insert statement is executed, and if everything goes well, blog.php is called again. Of course, blog.php runs the select statement, and here is my new page. Thank you for your attention.